Let's get the next panel in. We got Diageo. Hi, good to see you.
Hey, how are you?
Nick, how are you? Fresher.
You've lost that hat. What happened?
No, we're changing the scene. We're changing the scene. And also, Fresher and I, full disclosure, Adam and I are former colleagues. This is a coincidence. But when I saw your name on the list, I went with the old Viacom T so that you and I can connect virtually. So you're on mute, Adam. So let's come off.
Yeah, just working through that virtual background.
Yeah, it takes a minute. It definitely, and by the way, I was thinking also as I came into this, normally we're on the stage and there's a countdown clock and there's an audience, but the lights are so bright, you can't see the audience anyway. So I feel like we're in the same boat we were in 2 years ago.
That's right. Right now I'm mostly concerned with whether or not I'm mirroring my background or if you guys are seeing it straight.
I think
we're seeing it straight. It looks great. And I'm hoping mine does too, because I'm locked in a cupboard. But anyway, and hoping my dog doesn't bark. Here we go.
So yeah, I'm going to pass it to Adam, who's the moderator. He's the head of East Coast sales at Tastemade and a great person. And I'm going to bail out and I'll see you guys in about 30 minutes. Good luck.
Ah, what an intro and what a pleasure to see your face, Pete, for two times in a short period of time. And great to meet you, Sophie, and great to see you again, Frank. Super excited for our chat this morning. Let's start by way of quick intros. Sophie Kelly, like I said, great to meet you. Senior Vice President of the Whiskey's Portfolio in North America at Diageo, a campaign US 40 over 40 honoree. First SVP to oversee marketing for the whiskey portfolio. Congrats to all of it and great to meet you.
Thank you.
And Frank Rodriguez, partner, CEO at Anomaly. Great story, Frank, as you rose through the ranks there to become the youngest partner ever at Anomaly. Great to see you as well. And you guys leave me realizing that I need to be working harder. But in the meantime, I love what I do and I love where I'm at, running the best sales team in the biz over at Tastemade for the East Coast. So shout out to Tastemade and everybody who's tuning in around the industry. So wanted to just start with kind of a little overview before we jump into a sizzle for everybody. But for over a decade now, Diageo and Anomaly have been working together to build brands both domestically and abroad. And you guys continue to not only tap into the cultural zeitgeist, but also inform it and influence it. And you do so authentically, provocatively, and also often entertainingly. And so over the course of our chat this morning, we're going to dive into what it takes to connect with that modern consumer in a world where, despite having so many amazing legacy brands, laurels are not to be rested on, and in some cases, even discarded altogether. So I'm excited to dive in with both of you. We'll make sure to leave a little bit of room at the end for some Q&A. For those of you just joining, there's a Q&A widget at the bottom of your Zoom screen. But Frank sent through this amazing video just recapping some of the most recent great work that Anomaly and Diageo have done together. So Ryan or Vishal, if you could run that would be great.
Mexican devotion is at the heart of this industry.
Cantando llores. We're all a local somewhere. So visit your local.
Carro, una mansión y un jalapeño pa' meterle toda la canción. Y sí, 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 tú sabes que esto es en el party. Seguimos rompiendo hasta abajo como en el house party. Fra, fra, fra.
We don't stay in the shoes now. We'll hold build the scene. Then a whole rave may begin to call the boss dies. Chills and behind me, get a cold. Bevers is staying yet, Bill Joe.
Great costumes, guys. Who's who? Orange, is that you?
What's up, guys?
Oh, my God.
Why are you naked?
Oh, God. Is my camera on?
Oh, my God.
I'll never unsee this.
Okay, hold on.
Captain Morgan Sliced Apple. Lemon. Wanted to introduce you guys.
We already met.
Oh, yeah. It was delicious.
So you guys are like a thing?
Yeah.
No.
I mean, no.
No.
Are we fighting? Oh, my God. This is our first fight.
I'll have a Gordon's and tonic, please.
Regular or elderflower tonic?
Regular.
Lime or peppercorns?
Cubed
or artistic ice?
Can I just...
Miniature umbrella or curly straw?
What?
Shaken or stirred?
Stirred.
Somewhere out west, Lone River does run. It carves and cuts and clears its own path, and the work is never done. In this hard and sometimes hostile place, the river made a home on the edge of the unknown.
So good. So good.
That was fun.
Yeah. Yeah. The music was, it was great too. Frankie,
it's the soundtrack, it's the soundtrack to my life. I feel like I'm a musical schizophrenic. So a little bit of country, a little bit of reggaeton, a little bit of everything.
Yeah. Yeah. Kept me dancing. I know you're a 90s hip hop guy too, which I am too. So we got an offline about that. Awesome, guys. So, amazing work. So let's jump into it. You know, Frankie, early on, I know when you were standing up the Toronto Anomaly office, you instituted what might sound simple to some, but I love it for so many reasons. You instituted a yearbook. And I think at this time, there was only just a handful of you in the office, and maybe even fewer clients. But you did it to instill joy within your blossoming culture. You know, there's something familiar about a yearbook. And most importantly, it's a way to celebrate each other and also a way to celebrate your partners and your clients. Like I said, I love this for a lot of reasons, but especially for the maxim that what you celebrate, you duplicate. I think that certainly resonated with me. That said, bringing it back to this is something certainly worth celebrating for your and Sophie's respective teams is the recent Gold Effie Award for sustained success, which is arguably the hardest and most coveted of the Effie Awards to win, as it requires a consistent strategy for over 5 years with proven results. The win was for Crown Royal's Igniting the Spirit of Generosity campaign. So first off, congratulations, both of you and your respective teams on that amazing win. Sophie, starting with you, I'd love it if you could describe what that long-term strategy was or is, and why it's been so important for Diageo and Crown to remain consistent in your marketing approach?
Yeah, sure. I mean, yeah, we're hugely honored. It's a major award, and I speak for all the teams involved. We're just so thrilled to have been acknowledged in that way, because it's really difficult to win these. I think, so if I take it back, it's based on a really strong insight about that's true to the brand and true to the consumer. And it's all around the notion of the fact that Crown is a gift that gets given. It is an icon of status in the liquor brands world. And it was originally given as a gift to the King and Queen of England. But more importantly, the insight came around a time when we were trying to define what status meant to a new generation of consumers, which was really that it wasn't about what you had or what you were collecting, but what you could give. And therefore we landed on the purpose of inspiring exceptional generosity. What I would say is that we can own that because actually it's true to the way we turn up and what we do in communities that we participate in. And we also have this magnificent purple bag that holds our bottle that is the ultimate sign of generosity. So, you know, what we did was we actually took that velvet bag and we said, not only is this all about being the ultimate gift to someone, but how do we turn that purple bag into an act of generosity? And this became our mission underpinning the purpose for the brand to inspire generosity. You know, you asked kind of two questions. That's where we started, and we're going to get into more of it. But the other question you asked is, how do you stay consistent? And, you know, I mean, I think big point here is when you think about being consistent or you think about changing clients, changing agency teams, you know, it's important to go back to saying we have a strong purpose, it's grounded in a strong insight, and it's true to the brand. And just because you're consistent doesn't mean you have to be dull or that you can't innovate and adapt across your trademark. And I think one of the successes of Crown is the fact that, you know, we have a very strong platform that underpins the brand, inspiring exceptional generosity. It's based on an insight. It's true to the brand. It's true to the way the brand turns up in culture. And it is not just about talking, but it's about acts. And then we have identified experiences that people are wanting from whiskey, like flavor, format. And we've moved into those areas to take us into being more relevant for people and giving people the experiences that they're looking for in different occasions. And when I talk about that, I talk about how Apple, Crown Apple turns up and actually our recent work on Crown Can. So, you know, consistency doesn't mean dull or not adapting to culture. It's actually quite the opposite. It's just about knowing who you are and what you stand for. So hopefully that helps.
Yeah, that certainly does help. And going back to the insight, you had said, you know, based on what you can give versus what you have, right, as being the way that someone is valued within today's societal norms. And I think that's such a powerful insight to build off of. And therefore, you know, the tagline, if you live generously, life will treat you royally, you know, just makes so much sense under that context. So thanks for that explanation. Frankie, I've heard you say that Anomaly's early approach to identifying the company's vision was to start at the end and work backwards. I'd love to hear you talk a little bit more about that, because I feel that approach isn't limited to successfully achieving only internal objectives, but also longer term branding objectives on behalf of your partners, as was and is the case here with Crown.
Yeah, it's great. I think that's right. We talk a lot about Anomaly. Start at the end. You know, I think a lot of times you get in trouble when you're sort of navigating, and look, we're in such complicated times, right? I think 2020, the word of the year, was probably unprecedented, right? Sort of all of us facing all these different challenges, personally, professionally, and certainly for brands, you know, that we work on. And we say that one of the biggest challenges, you know, you face in that context is sort of making decisions based solely on where you are right now, as opposed to starting way at the end and then working back. And, you know, we talk about that certainly from an entrepreneurial perspective. So if you're starting an agency or a company or any creative company, you know, what type of company do you want to have? How do you want your employees to talk about it in your own personal career? And then for brands. And I think, you know, you again use Crown Royal as a perfect example. And I think Sophie did a fantastic job of kind of taking you on the journey of, you know, where the insight started. And then, but I think when we thought about that, right, we thought about, okay, Crown Royal is going to stand for generosity, right? Inspire and enable. Right. And I think it's important, the twofold, right? Inspire and enable generosity. And I'm sure every agency hopes to do this when you come up with a new creative platform. You want to believe it can stand the test of time, right? It's not going to be a, you know, one and done 6 month, 9 month campaign around some cultural moment and then you're on to the next thing. And so we, you know, in a very humble way, but every time we bring something forward, we go, this is a 3 to 5 year platform. What does it look like 5 years from now? What will we have achieved? Right, with a brand like Crown Royal, if we're going to be about generosity, right? How will we 5 years from now, do we expect new drinkers in the category to look at our brand and go, they're actually about it? And I think Sophie touched on it, right? The way we, I like to believe, did it successfully with Crown Royal is we earned our place in culture, right? We didn't claim our place in culture. We didn't say, this is what we're gonna be about. Now let's go tell everyone, right? We went, no, we're gonna earn our place in culture. And you do that, it takes time, right? It takes multiple years. Sophie talked about the purple bag. You know, I love the purple bag. I love a bit of flash. I love all things that, you know, are shiny and bright. And I think you just go, the fact that it, you know, represents our product and holds our product is incredible. But the purple bag project as an example, right? To sort of, which again, the brand did and Sophie and her team did, right? Taking those purple bags and filling them with things and sending them to soldiers, right? Sort of literally going, no, this purple bag, we don't want consumers just to see it on our product and think of the communication, the advertising that they may have seen. We actually want them to think of an action, a behavior, something we've done in earnest that's you know, actually stood for generosity. So I think you start at the end and you go, so what will we have accomplished? What will we have done? And it's never just, it can never be achieved through just communication, right? Often it really is about brand behaviors. Behave like the brand you want to be. And so when you look at that 5 years for Crown Royal, I would say there's a sliding scale, right? In the beginning, first year one and two, it was largely comms, certainly some actions, right? And then over time, if you look at the last few years, I mean, you know, you just go so many things that we were actually doing for our consumers to enable that generosity.
Yeah, and I think the only thing I'd add to that, Frankie, is like the notion of, yes, when you start, not everyone's gonna get it, right? What you're doing is you're creating belief behind a purpose that you believe is the right thing for the brand to own. And then when you have that, if you get into the system and you look at how your consumers are kind of interacting with the brand, what are they doing with the brand? What's happening with the brand in retail? And then how can you tie that together to support the purpose of inspiring exceptional generosity? And that's where the purple bag came from, right?
Yeah.
So that is now an initiator of generous acts in culture that we activate, whether it be the CMAs and packing bags to send to the military, whether it be disaster relief for fires or floods in Louisiana, and we go down and we pack those bags for essential gear. This is actually something that we discovered was happening in store where, you know, at Christmas time, people would bring in their leftover bags and they would put them in a letterbox, and then we would pack them and send them overseas to the military with goodies to tell them that we were thinking of them. So really, this was something that people were doing that we as a brand grabbed hold of and made a major enabler of the purpose of inspiring generosity. So the other thing I would say is have a look at how your consumers are interacting with you, because there are a lot of clues there.
Yeah, I'm feverishly jotting down notes. So much goodness. Yeah. You know, a couple of things that I just want to kind of touch back on is the notion of earning versus claiming a place in culture. And we'll get into that in a little bit as we talk about the next gen consumer and even ESG initiatives. But I think that's the only way to look at it. And the risk in that, the challenge in that, is the time that it takes, right, Sophie? And then the need for top-down support in that runway and that commitment and that belief that earning it is what's ultimately going to pay dividends and not claiming it from the onset. The other thing the other thing that stood out to me too is at the start, not everybody's going to get it, but belief behind your purpose. So you're putting something out there, right? You're taking a stance, you're choosing a POV, right? And then you're putting it out in the world. I think what digital today offers, right, which is why it's no longer a tactic, and we could talk a little bit more about that too, but it offers the opportunity to listen, right? Which was what I heard kind of first and foremost, which is how are the consumers using the product, right? And then allowing that to transform, inform, evolution within your brand, thus giving them equity, right? Or IP equity in your product. What better way to get a consumer on board than by giving them the perception that they had a hand in devising it, right? And I love that. At TasteMade, we have a hashtag, Taste Made Me Do It. And it's as simple as it sounds, but we're out there, you know, showing and telling and educating and inspiring. And all of a sudden what we saw was that our community, in the tune of millions, were coming back at us and saying, look what you inspired me to do. And then what we take from that is inspiration ourselves. And then we show them, you know, within the picture book. And as we know, the first thing you look for when you open up a photo album, as Mary Zambri, who a former Viacom, told me, and it stuck with me, is the first thing you look for when you open up a photo album is a picture of yourself. So how do we show them a picture of themselves? So really great stuff there, guys. Frankie, you had mentioned, obviously, you know, COVID and unprecedented times. I'd love to hear both of you speak a little bit more to the fact that, you know, to win the Effie Award for sustained success in any 5-year period is amazing, but to do so in a year where an unprecedented truly time was in the middle of that sustained approach, I think, you know, even more kudos to you guys and the team. How do you stay on strategy when something like that gets thrown in the mix?
I mean, yeah, great question. It's, you know, Frankie and I, and many people at Anomaly and at Diageo, we've talked about this a lot, right? It was like, this has been a horrendous time and such a time of heartache and destruction for so many people. And then, you know, quite polarizing. So for many people, it's like, how do you react? What do you do? What do brands have a right to do in this time when so many people are suffering so badly? So in one way, I like to think that we were lucky having the purpose we had, which is inspiring exceptional generosity, because we had absolutely no excuse but to get in the game and get in the game at large. And we have a purpose at Diageo, which is about celebrating life in every way. And what that became was, it's got to be about supporting the people who have supported us. So that became about, how do we turn our marketing into a cause-driven platform that will help the hospitality industry immediately, right? So when you look at what we did with, if you want me to say, that was getting together with people who have been involved in the brand, Anthony and Ari Lennox, re-recording the song with the purpose for people to stream it and raise money for bars, clubs, and stages across America. I think that hit digital to your point, Adam, and within 4 days had raised $2.7 million, okay, and still went on. You know, we had generosity hours, which were primarily in-person experiences in bars across the country. What are we going to do with them? We're going to shut them down. We're going to take them digital. And every time you're enjoying one of our influencers or one of our creators on Thursday for an hour digitally, take a photo of your drink and we will donate $1 to the USBG to support bartenders across the country. Like Bullet Bartender Fund was all about taking a picture and uploading it, and we will support. So really this became a huge opportunity to turn our marketing into a cause-driven platform that helped the hospitality industry. And by the way, it's not over. It's embedded in all of the stuff we're doing still today. So out of great crisis often comes huge opportunity to really create bigger impact in the world. And I think that's what we did right the way across Diageo and actually right the way across our whiskey brands. So I'm super proud of the impact we created and the fact that we didn't get, put off by how are you going to do it? How many people are you going to reach? Are people going to criticize you? We just went in there and did everything we could. So I don't know, Frankie.
No, listen, Sophie, I think you said it perfectly. I think I would summarize that just to go, and so I'm just kind of trying to pay attention to the chat a little bit along the side, and someone touched on it, right? I think, you know, it was John commented, right? I love that you said it takes time. I just go, you need to mean it. You need to believe it and you need to earn it. I mean, and I think Sophie said it, we were fortunate, generosity. When you think about the state we've all been in the last 18, 20 months, there certainly is a place to bring that to life. But I just think, you know, you hear so much about new media and listen, it's exactly right, right? Digital, it's not a channel, right? It's like oxygen. It's everything now. And you hear all the statistics about shrinking attention spans and 5 seconds and no one pays attention anymore and we just need thumb stopping. But I think as marketers sometimes maybe we make the mistake to think that is mutually exclusive from long term and sticking with, like, I think we got to give the consumers a little bit more credit. You need things in the moment for sure, but I think certainly younger consumers, we're seeing it more and more and more and more, they give a crap, right? And so they connect the dots. And I think sometimes as brands and marketers, we don't stick long enough. Yeah. We don't tell, you know, we talk a lot about the sum is greater than the parts. Like,
right.
I might see something on Instagram. I might see it, but over time I'm standing all the way back and just go, is that brand just talking about generosity all the time? Or have they actually done anything that genuinely matters for me, for, you know, the communities that I'm a part of, for the values and the things that I care about? And I think that's what Crown did brilliantly. And I think it, you know, someone else mentioned it starts at the top. So I think you go when you have Sophie, you know, at her level across the organization, Diageo going, no, this is what Crown Royal stands for. We're not going to throw the baby out with the bathwater. Yes, everything has changed. So therefore the way our idea and the way our strategy and the way our work manifests out in the world will change as a result of COVID, but what we actually stand for and what we're trying to accomplish absolutely will not. And when you say that out loud and you mean it, well, then everyone just gets excited, rallies behind it. And then all these other ideas start popping up of what can we actually do? So it's exciting.
And I mean, I think I'd say also, it's an obvious statement, but consistency doesn't look like the same thing. It's the value that holds a brand together. If you want me to say, it does not look the same as backpacking for the CMAs, does not look the same as the retail activation that runs through every single, you know, retail outlet across the country. Yeah. Does not look the same as, you know, the Texan rodeo, right? But the act of having to do something that benefits the community that you're serving is critical and what ties it together.
So much goodness there. Thank you guys. And I think that, you know, that then kind of flows really nicely into, you know, when we talk about top-down support, it really sounds like Ivan Menezes, your CEO, practices what he preaches, right? You know, he doesn't just talk about ESG as a nice to have. But what I've heard you say, Sophie, he puts it on par with every other major KP.
Absolutely. I mean, you see the smile on my face. And the fact of the matter is that, you know, one of the reasons I work at Diageo is because our performance ambition has purpose at the heart of it, has our 2030 Diageo in society goals in relation to climate, in relation to inclusivity and diversity, in relation to what we are doing to support our communities. And it is right up there with our business performance. And what's great about that is I think that if the last 18 months showed us anything as marketers and brand owners and business practitioners, is that good is the right thing to do, but it's also the right thing to do for business results, because it's where consumers are putting their money and it's how they're making their choices. I mean, if you look at a bullet, Shelbyville in Lebanon, first sort of carbon neutral distillery in Kentucky, like huge, right? Massive investment, but the right investment for the future. You know, in some ways, I feel lucky because, you know, I've been given permission at a very high level to do what I believe in, which is to drive purpose and impact in society. So, I think it gives way to amazing work, amazing creativity, transformation, and it continually reminds us when done well that it pays off.
Totally. You had said something that I had heard via a podcast, I think, that you were on, but, and you've touched on it again here, but when consumers are given the option, they tend to go with brands with whom their values most align, right? And we know now more than ever that there's more options than ever, right? And so therefore, you know, Frankie, to your earlier point, you know, it's not a nice to have, it's a must have, and it's not an afterthought, but just like the way we were talking about digital as no longer being a tactic, it needs to be the strategy, right? Like digital is king in that sense, as is, you know, the way you show up in culture and society. Sophie, you talked a little bit about Bullet and what I believe to be one of the biggest distilleries in the world of its kind, or at least in the States, in Lebanon, that is carbon neutral. So that's awesome. You know, there's so many of those kind of great stories that show that you practice what you preach, whether it's your partnership with American Forest, also with Bullet, where you planted 1 million trees over the course of a handful of years, and but not just any trees, but the white oaks, which then go back to the cask making and just have it be, you know, purely cyclical. Frankie, when we were speaking the other day, I really heard the passion in, you know, some of the Johnny Walker and Jane Walker, approaches to ESG, and also, you know, we were saying that it's hard to disseminate ESG from next gen marketing tactics, right? Because they're almost one in the same, right? Who is that next consumer? And we know that he, she, and they are passionate about all of it. Frankie, either one of those two, whether it be the origins of Jane Walker or Johnny Walker, particularly maybe around the 2016 election, that sure. Really most with you.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, look, I think I'll go back real quick on one thing though, because I think, like you said before, which is 100% true, right? You know, I think you said something to the effect of, you know, young consumers today want to choose brands that, you know, share their values or align with their values. And that I think is exactly right. But again, I just want to reemphasize, I think it's about the actions, not just words, right? Like we did research like last year, 2020. And again, there was a big study from Kantar. And I think it was, the numbers were staggering. I think it was something like 55% of total consumers expect brands to back up words with actions, right? To step in. And I think that number was significantly higher than when you talked about multicultural audiences. It was like 65% for Latino and 70% plus. So I think it's not just share my values and talk about them. It's you know, a little bit of what have you done for me lately, right? Like, what is the brand actually doing? But for your specific question, listen, you touched something that's, you know, near and dear to my heart. I mean, Johnny Walker, you know, keep walking. I mean, a campaign that's been around for ages, and I think it was BBH that cracked the line. It's a fantastic piece of advertising, but in modern marketing, we spend a lot of time going, well, how do we activate, right? I think the perspective of what progress means in this country is very different today than it was 25 years ago, for sure. And I think if you think about progress and what it means in the last 5 years in this country, it's also very, very different. So yeah, it was 2016, you know, one of my absolute favorite things we ever did. And it was an ad. I mean, we created an advertisement for Johnny Walker, Keep Walking America. It ran on election night. The voiceover was the lyrics of the Woody Guthrie poem, which is often referred to as this great country's second national anthem, This Land Is Your Land. And look, I just get emotional still, sorry, talking about it. But halfway through, you know, the narration, the lyrics then switched to Spanish, right? Esta tierra fue hecha para ti, para mí. And I think to hear that in Spanish on the national stage, and it was not a political play, by the way. We were not, you know, we had no, sure, emotional investment personally, but as a brand, we were not voicing an opinion or making a statement. We were basically saying, irrespective of who wins this election, the future of this country will be determined not by the president or the government, but by the people. Oh, and hey, by the way, Latinos, we see you. We know how important you are to this nation. And we know that progress in this country will largely be determined by what you do and what you contribute. And that for me, I mean, we touched the sky with that, you know, and
yeah. And I mean, I think, you know, yeah. You to add to Frankie, it's so emotional, but then you look at what we did in the recent election where we continued that story with Brittany Howard re-recording, you know, Walk On, Never Walk Alone. And that was all about a call to, again, whatever happens in this particular moment, continue to move forward. And I think Frankie said it, it's like, you know, we are forever challenging ourselves to put the notion of collective progress out there in a way that actually, you know, moves, you know, minority communities forward, because that's, you can't talk about progress without standing for progress amongst marginalized and minority communities. And that is a big effort from the brand. And we will continue to hopefully do that with impact.
Yeah, that's right. I would say, Sophie, by the way, just because I know you won't give yourself credit for it, but like Jane Walker, right? Like I think very few people would appreciate how hard it would have been to pull that off, right? As an agency, sure, we can dream up any and everything. On the client side, so for all the clients, I guess, who are on this call, to have the, you know, conviction to go and push. I mean, I don't know, Johnny Walker's a 100-plus-year-old brand, and that logo and icon has stood the test of time and never once changed. But to change Johnny Walker to Jane Walker, to really mobilize, not again, a one-off, you know, how do we lean into frame around women's history and just do a thing, but how do we actually genuinely create a platform that we can run year over year over in that does something meaningful for women? I just think it's, you know, those things, nothing great ever comes easy. And I think like the willingness to kind of go, no, I know this is the right thing to do. Let's not go in and create a women's scotch, but let's actually welcome a new audience into the scotch, you know, sort of